Our topic for today is about electric field. And to give you an introduction about electric field, consider this three-dimensional space. And let's choose any position here in this three-dimensional space. For example, at this point, let's call this point P. And at point P, we position a test charge. Let's call it capital Q. Now, if there is a source charge here, let's name it Q sub 1. And another source charge here with the shape of a Q, Q sub 2. And here, Q sub 3. And another point charge, Q sub 4. And so on. So Coulomb's law states that if all these source charges have non-zero charge, then they can exert an electric force on our test charge capital Q. So if I try to write down Coulomb's law here, the net force on charge Q is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught times the charge of Q times the summation of the influence of all the source charges. So equals 1 to n Q sub I over r sub I squared r hat. If I remove the test charge Q here at point P, it doesn't mean that Q sub 1 and Q sub 2, Q sub 3, Q sub 4 or all other source charges loses its influence on point P. In fact, if I place a new test charge here at point P and let's designate it as capital Q sub 2, then this Q sub 2 will experience a force due to Q sub 1, Q sub 2, and Q sub 3, and Q sub 4. In other words, even if I remove the test charge at point P, if we place any kind of charge here, it will experience a force due to the source charges Q sub 1, Q sub 2, and so on. We can rename such influence as a field. In physics, there is a general definition for field. A field is a vector quantity that is a function of position, and such position is measured relative to the source of the field. So we call this field as electric field because it originates from electric charges. So the electric field at point P is actually the vector sum of the individual influences of the source charges. That is, if you have point charges. So for example, let's focus on Q sub 1. Any charge creates an electric field in its vicinity, but because of Newton's third law, a charge is not affected by its own electric field. Only the electric field generated by other charges can apply force on that specific charge. So we established the fact that when you have source charges, it actually alters the properties of a point in space in such a way when you place another charge on that point, that charge will experience an electric force. Again, let's focus on one charge, for example, Q sub 3. When suddenly you place a charge Q sub 3 in this position, it alters its surrounding by means of an electric field. Now, if we measure that electric field at point P and then we move this point P farther away from Q sub 3, then the measured electric field actually weakens because it's a function of position. Nevertheless, when source charges alter its surroundings, when it fills all space with electric field, this electric field has an infinite reach in all directions. So later I will discuss the concept of electric field line so we can visualize this electric field. So going back to Coulomb's law, this is our equation for Coulomb's law. And notice that if we remove the test charge here, we'll end up with 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught summation of the individual contribution of the point source charges divided by their distances from a point. And this point P is actually the point where we would like to measure the influence of these charges. So instead of calling this as a force, and notice that it wouldn't have a unit for force, then we could just name this as a field or electric field, symbolized by capital E. And we measured it based on a specific position. And for now, let's call this position capital P. In other words, this P actually means a point in space or refers to x, y, z coordinates. So again, this is our equation for electric field. This is our definition for electric field coming from Coulomb's law. So once we define electric field with this equation, then we can just multiply the electric field of source charges with a test charge to calculate for the electric force on that test charge Q. This is our definition of electric field. It is the influence of source charges at point P in such a way when we place any test charge Q on that point, we can calculate for the resulting electric force. Now, we study the concept of electric field because oftentimes we are given information about the source charges and we would like to know how it alters its surrounding without any idea about the test charge. So basically, when you have an information about the source charge, we could calculate for electric field. And when we are given any test charge in space, then we can easily calculate for the electric force on that test charge because we already have prior information about electric field. So when we calculate the electric field of given source charges, it is easy to calculate the force for any given test charge. So that's the importance of electric field. It allows you to describe the ability of source charges to apply force on any test charge. So far, what we have discussed is the calculation of electric field from a group of point source charges. In reality, charges stick to an extended body with measurable length or volume. For example, charges can accumulate in very long thin wires. For example, we have a piece of wire and charges can accumulate along this wire. And obviously, this object has a length. Let's call this length L. Or we can also consider sheet of charges like this one. Charges can accumulate on this surface and so on. Obviously, this sheet of charges has a measurable area. And finally, the most common one is that charges are possessed by a continuous three-dimensional object with a volume. Again, charges can accumulate inside this object or on the surface of the object, and this object has a measurable volume. Now, in any problem, unless otherwise specified, we always assume that charges are evenly distributed when they are located in any of these configurations. To facilitate the calculation of electric field, we define the following terms. Consider this very thin wire. It has a length of L. And if we just consider an infinitesimal length d sub L, here, we can consider a very small portion of this wire and name it as d sub L, this infinitesimal length d sub L. So for line charges, we define the concept of linear charge density symbolized by small lambda. And this refers to charge per unit length or has an SI units of coulomb per meter. So if this entire wire here has a charge of Q, then linear charge density is equal to Q over L, or if we just consider a small portion of this wire, this is equal to the value of charge here is dQ. So this is dQ over dL. Next, if we have surface charge, we define surface charge density as charge per unit area, and it is symbolized by small sigma. Again, this is charge per unit area, and it has an SI unit of coulomb per m squared. If a total charge Q is distributed all over this surface with area A, then surface charge density is equal to total charge on that surface divided by the area of that surface. Now, if we just consider infinitesimal area here, which has an area of dA, or infinitesimal area dA, and it has a charge of dQ, then surface charge density is also equal to dQ over dA. Again, we have an assumption that the charge on this area is evenly distributed, and their total charge is capital Q. Finally, for volume charges, if we have this object with volume V, we define volume charge density as the charge per unit volume of this charge object. And it is symbolized by small rho, and it has an SI unit of coulomb per m cubed or meters cubed. And again, if the total charge of this object is Q, then obviously the volume charge density is equal to rho equals capital Q divided by V. But we can also calculate volume charge density by considering a small portion of this volume here. With infinitesimal volume of dV and charge of Q, then this is dQ, infinitesimal charge dQ. Then volume charge density rho is also equal to dQ over dV. Now, going back to the charge distributions. Notice that if I want to calculate the electric field at this point from this wire, so if I begin at this infinitesimal element dq, then symbolize this electric field at this point P as d sub e. Notice that if I try to put an imaginary coordinate here, I can actually break this dE here into its component. So it has dE sub y, a component along the y-axis, and dE sub x, or its component along the x-axis. Suppose we want to calculate influence of electric field in this portion or infinitesimal length d sub l on this side. So that's a distance of r at this point P, and obviously its electric field is now going on this point, assuming that the charge on the wire is positive. So we can represent the electric field on this point due to this d sub l as d sub e, and obviously we can also break this down into component, this d here. So it also has a y component d e y and another component d e sub x. Now notice that this component cancels out, assuming that they are in equal distance from point P. But the y component of their electric fields, dE sub y, adds up. So in other words, no matter what points you choose, oftentimes, some of the electric field component from the infinitesimal contribution of a charge distribution cancels out. So even if you choose, for example, a surface, what is the electric field on this point? So if you try to calculate the influence of this infinitesimal area on this point P, then it has an electric field here. And also, if you want to calculate the influence of this infinitesimal area here on point P, and if you try to break this into component, the component along the x-axis in this example cancels out, but the component along the y-axis adds up. The same goes when you calculate for the electric field of a volume charge. Don't forget to like this video, subscribe to my YouTube channel, and hit the notification bell button for awesome updates. Thank you for watching!